Hi everyone. I work at University of the Western Cape with Roy Martins as my supervisor and Mario Santos. That's the best I could do. I will first introduce you to the SKA, which is will be one of the largest telescopes, one of the largest telescopes in the world, radio telescopes, and it will help us to understand a lot of the phenomena that we are wondering about, such as dark matter, dark energy, and also the formation of the first star, and the epoch of ionization, and many, many other things, including even if they're the aliens in the universe and they're trying to communicate with us. So I'm more interested in the BAO, and the BAO is a baryonic acoustic oscillation and is measured by the angle subtended by this. It's a standard ruler, so the angle is subtended by this ruler, the function of redshift. And we map the angular diameter distance, which is the tangential component. And we could also measure the Hubble parameter by measuring the redshift interval. And actually, the BAO is very good prop for dark energy because, firstly, it's the principle of the BAO coming from the physics, that we know. So it's well understood from that concept. And also it's easy to be measured at higher redshift, which makes it complementary to other props such as supernovae. So in this presentation, I will be talking about the cosmological performance of the SKA H1 galaxy survey in measuring the BAO. So to do this type of forecasting, we need to know about the telescope specifications and the survey specifications, and then how many galaxies that your telescope will be able to see, and also the bias. Then you could do the forecasting. So let's talk about the telescope specifications. The SKA will be built in two phases, phase one and phase two. So phase one, it will be built in South Africa, which is 250 four dishes, and it will be in mid-frequency, and they also will have also dense cores, also mid-frequency, and another 96 dishes will be in Australia, and will be more like low frequency receivers. And the phase two, it's actually not specified 100%, but the target is increase the sensitivity 10 times of the mid and third frequency. So the one in Australia and the one in the South Africa is like a pathfinder for the SKA phase two. And And we need also the field of view to be 20 times of the phase one. And one of the plans that they're discussing is to make it at the spiral arm. So this is the Karoo in South Africa. And the white things mean there's no populations, and the red places where the people are. And so the idea is to make the radio telescope in very empty areas, at least the core. And then this spiral arms to guarantee more field of view, but the core will be, most of the dishes will be inside the core. And actually those spiral arms actually goes up to Mauritius in this area, and one of them also goes up to Ethiopia and Ghana in the middle of Africa. So that was the telescope specification. Now for the survey, we need to balance between the sensitivity and the area of the survey. So it's very important. You don't want to, you would like to go wide, and that's great. You get larger volume axis. That means greater access to Fourier modes. But you don't want to go too wide, because you decrease your sensitivity and you will increase the shot noise. And also the maximum redshift will decrease. And one of the most important terms to define the survey specifications is the flux sensitivity, the SRMS, which is the noise associated with the flux measured by the interferometer. So MERCAD is a plus the MID will make the 254 dishes together, because MERCAD will be 64 dishes, and then whatever you add to it MID to make the total of the phase one. So this is phase one in South Africa, and this is phase one in Australia. And we could see that the sensitivity is not, the noise is associated with the interferometer is high. It's 152 microjanisky and 179 for the Australian one. But the idea is that SKA2 will go as low as 5 microjanisky, which is a really low number. And then also the survey area is very important. So SKA phase one can go for H1 survey. It's to be able to resolve galaxies, we can't go more than 5,000. Not more, but I will explain just now. And for SKA2 is 30,000. So to know which is the best area to choose for the survey, we do the figure of merit. And figure of merit is a way to compare two experiments, which one is better. You just associate a number, which is the figure of merit, to an experiment. You determine it by doing the Fisher matrix, which is 2 by 2, and the elements of our interest here is the dark energy parameter, so it's W not WA, and then you just take the inverse and the determination and the square root, you get the figure of merit. And we did it for two sets of frequency. And you could see here that it peak up around 5,000 for this 800, 1,300. And the other one is good, but it peaks up later at 25,000, which means it's more optimized to do it at this at the area 5,000 than any other. So this is the one we will adapt with this frequency. So now we want to know how many galaxies our survey will be able to detect. So we do use a simulation, a semi-analytical simulation, and the simulation provide the H1 luminosity and the line profile and also the redshift, and from there you could calculate the number density. But before we do that, we pick up the galaxies according to that the rotation, the curve, the H1 line curve. We at least detect 2 points of the curve, at least 2 points, so we know that it's a galaxy. And that means we will ignore the face-on galaxies because this is the show you the because if you have two horns, that's guaranteed that is a galaxy. But if it is one peak, it might be a galaxy and it might be just noise. So we just threw away all the other maybe F R of I, or maybe it's a galaxy, but we just threw them away, and we make sure to take the galaxies at least has 2 points detected. And also the width of the line has to be larger than twice the assumed frequency. And the typical line usually is 10 kilometers per second, and the SKA2 will easily be able to detect that number. So this is the result from the simulation. And this is, we could see this is the sensitivity, the noise associated, the SRMS, with every, we did it for different type of telescopes with different noise, SRMS. And this is less, this is like for the SKA2, and this is here for the SKA phase one. And you could see that the noise actually makes it difficult to detect galaxies beyond this point for the, and it's affecting our detection. But when you go to, this is a perfect telescope with no noise, you get that this is actually what you could be able to detect if there's no noise associated with the telescope. So this is the points from the simulations, and this is actually we did fit the points from the simulation and produced equations that now even if you have a telescope and these numbers doesn't correspond to your noise, you could actually use the equations to produce whatever. No, without going back to the simulation, you could actually just use the equations to produce similar curves for different SRMS. And now for the bias, we extracted the galaxies and then we sorted them according to their redshift and position. And the bias, as many of us know, is just the square root of the power spectrum, the number power spectrum divided by the matter power spectrum, but we choose to do it at rate, at k 0.2 h divided by the megaparsec. And we assume that the bias is scale independent. And the same thing, we get also different bias values from the simulation. And for SKA 1 and 2. And we also developed an equation able to produce the bias with respect to redshift for different SRMSs. And now we did the simulation, we discussed the specification for the telescopes and the survey. Then now we could do the forecasting, and we will consider just a few SRMS values, we will consider 70 and 150 and 200 microjanisky as optimistic reference and worst scenario case. And for SKA2, it's 3 and 5 and 23 microjanisky. So first we start by forecasting for the BAO scale, DA and H. And we use the Fisher matrix. And the Fisher matrix is all actually the forecasting about the Fisher matrix, because you put the survey specifications and telescope specifications in your V survey. And it's already affected our number density here. And the bias will go in the power spectrum. And the two element INJ for us is the BAO scale, so it's DA and H. And after you get your Fisher matrix, you just take the square root of the inverse. And the first element is DA, and the second element is H, the error in H. And we could see that this is the error in H, and it's for SKA1. It's very expected that it won't do as good as the SKA2, but we just were forecasting to see how well it will do. And actually, it's not that bad, because if we compare the results with both, it's actually comparable how well the SKA1 will do, and the data could be complementary. And also, the intensity mapping will be done by SKA1, and it is more promising. For SKA2, we could see that the error could go down less than 0.5%, which is very good, and the same for the DA. And now you could transfer the error from the DA and H to any parameters you want, and we choose those parameters, and we could see that SKA1 with these specifications and SKA2 will do actually the dark energy parameter. It will be less than 0.05. And this will be a magnificent number, because you could actually now differentiate between models, and you could actually test if dark if the dark energy is dark energy or it is a modified gravity need to be implemented. Thank you.